Hi, welcome to Visual Studio Toolbox. I'm Robert Green here with Leslie Richardson, live and together in the studio. Very exciting. And we're joined by Phil Japixi.
Hey.
How are you?
I'm good. How about yourself?
Very good.
Doing great.
Good. So it's been a while since we've caught up. So last time I was here, I wasn't in my current job. So let me just take a moment to introduce myself for the people who haven't seen me or have followed us on the show.
Who doesn't know you, Phil?
Who doesn't know me, right? So 3 years ago, I took the job as CTO at Pintus & Mullins. We're one of the largest personal injury law firms in the U.S. So it was a very big change for me. I left consulting and I went into the legal field, which is very weird. I'm still Microsoft MVP, still very active in the speaker community, prolific author. My C-Sharp 10 book is doing great. I am a Scrum trainer, although it was funny. I got my Scrum, my PST certificate during COVID, right? And then I took the job as CTO, so I'm not teaching Scrum anymore. And I think that's it. Oh, I run the local user group and a conference in Cincinnati. So that's catching up with me.
Excellent.
Awesome.
Phil and I have done series on design patterns,
on
Entity Framework, and we're here to kick off another series on automated software testing.
Correct.
Which will be approximately 10 episodes. We're not quite sure. We know what topics we're going to cover, but we want to keep them nice and short, so some of the topics might take 2 episodes. We might decide to stretch them out to 3. So we'll figure about 10 or so, covering the gamut of automated software testing. And I guess the first question is, what's so important about automating software testing?
Well, the most important thing that we can do as developers is make sure the code behaves as we expect it to, right? I mean, the best thing we can do is have the code behave as our customers expect it to, right? But there's sometimes misinterpretations, right? So we can only go based on facts we know, right? That's what we want to do. That's where agile development comes in so handy, right? Because you're constantly demoing it and showing it, and they can say, that's not what I had in mind. But the worst thing is you go and build something to your understanding, and you go to demo it, and you go, ooh, I wasn't supposed to do that. And the customer's like, internal or external customer's like, wait a minute, what's going on? So we want a way to test it, right? So we could certainly hit F5 in Visual Studio and debug it and type a bunch of stuff. That takes time. Mm-hmm. And as developers, we don't like doing that. It's boring, right? You have QA departments to do things, but what a QA department is doing is they're testing the surface area. Right, they're not getting into the nitty gritty of how things are working.
But do people even still have QA departments?
Absolutely.
I thought a lot of that was the developers do the testing, and then you might have people do final testing. But
no, because I keep getting emails all the time at my Pintus email saying, "Hey, you know, we've got offshore QA. Do you want to hire them?" Right, you know, all the cold calls because they look at my LinkedIn profile. So QA is still a thing. Should it be a thing? Yes. Because I think we still need that holistic 10,000 foot testing view, right? But the biggest problem you're gonna run into is, again, it's a time thing. Let's say you have a password policy, that the password has to be a certain number of characters, has to have a number, has to have a dollar sign, capital letter, right? We can write an automated test very, very quickly to make sure that, and you can do a row test, which we'll show you when we get into one of the later episodes, where it's a data-driven test. So you have a whole bunch of different passwords, and it should return true or false if it passes the complexity test or not, right? And we can run that repeatedly, right? For a QA to do that, and they can certainly write a script, but they have to write all those, they have to log into the system or get to the login page. They have to put in a different password, right? And we've got an episode on UI testing, but we're also gonna show you how fragile UI testing can be, right? So instead of having QA do this when it's already deployed somewhere, shouldn't we be testing it before we deploy it, right? You know, and there's all kinds of charts and graphs of if you catch a bug or a defect in design mode, it costs this much to fix, and all the way to production, you know, how much it costs to fix. I'm pretty sure all those numbers are made up. But I think we can all agree that if something goes out in production that's wrong, to fix it is significantly more expensive and more work, right, than if we find it early on in the phase.
Right.
So the automated testing gives us a rapid feedback loop. As a developer, right? I'm gonna make this change, show me what happens. So that's one of the main things, right? So it gives you courage as a developer to make changes, right? Because we've all been in that situation where you're looking at this pile of code, right? And maybe it's a 1,000 line method called do it, right? And you know you have to make a change in there, and nobody wants to take that story, right? Because the code's just scary.
Yeah.
Right? So but if we had, well, first of all, if we had tests around it, it wouldn't be 1,000 lines. But if we had tests around it, right? And this is, you know, some ways that you can refactor legacy code. And you build a whole bunch of tests so that you know that when you make changes, you're going to know if you break something. We very seldom break things in the direct line of path, right? Mm-hmm. We usually break things with side effects, right? We've got this big method. It's not following single responsibility. It's doing a whole bunch of different things. And then, you know, we're testing our flight path of what we want to do, right? The change we want to make. But we're not testing the 27 other things this method is doing. Right? And I know you're probably thinking, well, you shouldn't do 28 things in a method. And you're spot on. You shouldn't.
You shouldn't.
But there's real life.
Yeah.
Right? And there's legacy code. We spend most of our time as janitors, not as construction. Right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We're usually cleaning up, whether it's our own code or somebody else's code, we spend more time cleaning it up. And if we had those tests in place and we needed to make a change, we'd have the courage to do that. Because I would know, you know, if I broke something else, the test would tell me.
Right.
Right.
But this goes beyond just what we're going to talk about. It goes beyond just writing the tests, because you could write the tests, write the code, run the test, look at the results, modify the code, rerun the test. So you've got the test, but that's kind of, isn't that a little more manual? So where's the automated part coming in?
Well, the automated part is that, so with frameworks like XUnit and MSpec, right, you just fire it off in the command line, right? Okay. So .NET test. Mm-hmm. Right, if you're running .NET 6 or any of the .NET Core /.NET, naming is hard. So you can run it from a command line, right? So you can make it part of your CI/CD process. Matter of fact, we're going to have an episode on that where we talk about tying it into Azure DevOps pipelines as well as GitHub Actions, right? So you can have these things. Every time you check in, the tests get run.
Okay.
Right, so you know, first of all, you don't want to break the build, right? That's kind of embarrassing because you could have run the build on your machine before you checked it in, but it happens, right? But you also, as a developer, we don't always say, oh, I have to run all the unit tests before I do a check-in, right? Should we? Probably, but mm-hmm. we'll talk about why sometimes you don't, because they take time. Like when we get an integration testing, we've got at least one episode on that. We were actually testing the database, and we'll talk about the semantics around that. So you don't always do that as a developer, right? So we want to make sure that it gets done somewhere, mm-hmm. right? And so before you deploy to staging, right, we want our pipeline to run those tests. So then we get that, again, that rapid feedback loop to telling us something's wrong.
Right.
The other thing that people don't always think about is estimation, right? Now, I think you've done episodes on estimation, and estimating's hard, right? They're estimates, not exactimates, right? But tests can help you, right? Let's say you've got pretty decent code coverage, right? And I don't want to focus on code coverage because it's actually a red herring typically, but let's say I've got 80% code coverage. Right, and I've been working in this code base for 6 months, you know, to build it up. And somebody comes and says, hey, we're going to use MySQL instead of SQL Server. You know, what's the impact? As developers, we kind of sit around and go, I don't know. Let's get a dartboard out and throw darts and find a number, right?
Yeah.
Well, what if you just change the driver? If you're using EF Core, change it from, you know, use SQL Server to use MySQL in your DB context options, and then run your tests.
Mm-hmm.
And if half of your tests fail, you know it took 6 months to get to where you were, it's probably 3 months of work, right? Because half of your code is now broken, right? But if 10 tests fail, right?
There you go.
Well, then you can use your best judgment, say it's a day or two or whatever.
Right.
Right.
That's awesome.
You know, Martin Feather said, you know, the difference between code and legacy code is tests, right? And he actually wrote a book, Working Effectively with Legacy Code. And it's a great book because when he talks about legacy code, it's not talking about COBOL or, you know, assembler or things like that. It's code that doesn't have tests around it, right? Because anytime you get in that situation and you go to make changes, at least I start to panic. I'm like, I'm dealing with case history in my current job, right? And these are people's livelihoods. Right, and legal things, right? If I lose case history, then I'm on the hook, right? Because it's very important that you keep that stuff. And so it's like, I don't want to make this change. Let's have tests around it, right? So again, it goes back to that courage. Right. It also makes your development faster.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to say.
I've had a bunch of managers, not recently, but early on in this whole testing phase, they're like, I'm not paying you to write twice as much code. And so one particular customer, I started writing tests and doing test-driven development, but I kept it on a separate solution. I never checked it into TFS. It shows you how back far it was, right? And what happened was my code had less and less defects than other developers' codes, right? And what I mean by defect, it's not varying from what the customer expects, is from what I expected to do, right? And things mm-hmm. that I was changing I wasn't having those side effect breaks. So what happened was, and I was a consultant, what happened was I started getting the project manager, again, showing you how old this project was, kept coming to me with more important stuff. And the FTEs were getting mad. The full-time employees, they're like, why is the consultant getting the good stuff? And I said, well, and the PM said, well, because his code works. Which put me in an awkward position, right? But then they came over and they said, what are you doing differently? And I said, you might get in trouble. I might let go, but you're an FTE. Do you want me to show you? And they said, yes. And so I showed them how I was doing the test-driven development and how I had this over here, and I was checking the code and making sure I wasn't breaking other things. And so they actually went to management, petitioned them, and they got tests allowed. Right, and so I took everything I had, brought it in. We did some lunch and learns, and they actually started implementing testing into it. Mm-hmm. Right, so it was faster because first of all, you're writing small, especially if you're doing test-driven development. I know we're going to talk about that later, or maybe this episode. I don't remember how we planned it, but you're only writing enough code to make this story pass. Right, so let's go back to the password complexity. I'm only writing enough code to validate the password. I'm not writing the password history. I'm not writing these other things, right? Just mm-hmm. enough code to make a pass. So I'm laser focused, right, as a developer, which helps, right? Because we tend to go, oh, squirrel, right? Yeah. You know, oh, I need to fix this. Let me stop what I'm doing. So you're writing smaller increments of code, and you're only writing enough code to make the test pass, right? As developers, we tend to gold plate, right? We tend to say, oh, they asked for this. They're going to ask for this. I'm just going to write it now, right? And then, oh, they're going to ask for this thing too. And now I've got a whole bunch of code they never asked for. I've taken time to build. Now we have to support it, right? It's a potential surface area for defects, mm-hmm. right? And so now I'm slowing down development.
Cool. So what we're going to cover in this series is how to automate your testing. Mm-hmm. Done a good job of summarizing not only why is testing important, but basically, the more you do and the easier you make it, the more you're going to do. And then that password thing, if you could write the code and then automatically run a test that you have a list of 100 different things that people can enter, and you run your code against that automated test, and when you get to the point where all 100 of them pass, you know your code works. So,
correct.
Yeah, it's pretty exciting that it's going to help you get the code right the first time. It might take you 10 times to write it, but the first time you check it in and show it to anybody else, yeah, that works. That covers everything anybody could think of, and you're the guy whose code works.
Right.
That's awesome.
There's one more thing we didn't cover, and that's behavior testing. Right. So there was a project I had. It was the shortest consulting gig ever because I went down, it was a bank, and they had a function where they wanted to get all their existing customers and all their products, and then all the products that customers had, and basically build a Venn diagram of who didn't have what product and give this to the salespeople, right? So they're doing all these get all. Well, they had nested them, right? So they got all the customers, they got all the products, and they got the which customers had which products. And it worked great on developer's machine, mm-hmm. right? And then it went into the integration environment. It didn't work as well, but it worked, right? So they released it into production. It brought their servers down, right? Stack Overflow. And so they brought me in, and I'm looking, and I'm going, if we just move these three get alls outside of the for loop, I think that fixes the problem. Mm-hmm. And we did that, and sure enough, it fixed the problem. So one thing we can do with MOQ, which is a mocking framework, and we have at least two episodes on that, is we can set up the behavioral expectations. I want this thing to run, but only once. And if it runs more than once, then you get an exception. So we can also check the behavior of our code, not just a static analysis of does this password pass or fail the test.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But do we actually call the logic to check the password? Or do mm-hmm. we just accept it, right? Or do we forget to, do we comment that out by accident because we were testing something?
Right.
Yeah, and that's cool because, once you reach the public, and then it's starting to have those issues that maybe weren't accounted for beforehand. That I feel like that's when it gets really stressful, trying to figure it out before things start to crash and burn from a customer standpoint.
And we're doing an upgrade from WebForms to .NET Core, or .NET now, and there's some very complicated logic that we have, and so in no tests, I inherited this code, and so what we're doing is we're writing mock behavior tests around all the existing code, so that when we do write it for .NET 6 and EF Core and SQL Server 2019, that we're at least checking the behavior, right? The structure of the code is going to be different, but the interfaces are the same, and we can use MOQ to make sure that from a behavior standpoint, we're doing the right thing in the upgraded version.
Great. All right. Can't wait to get started.
All right.
Which we will do next time on Visual Studio Toolbox.